Afternoon, everyone. And my pleasure to welcome you here as we welcome Clarence Page for his new book, a great collection of essays on race, politics, and social change called Cultural Worrier. I am David Cohen. I'm Carla Cohen's husband, and I love doing books here under the leadership of Brad Graham and Lissa Muscatine and the great staff here who have not only continued the traditions of politics and prose, but have made some wonderful additions and changes as well. And so in welcoming Clarence, I have to tell you a story that I heard just 10 minutes ago. This is Clarence's second book. His first one dealt with impolite essays in race and identity. And it was written in the 1990s, and his publisher failed him because he didn't get here. He got to Washington, but he didn't get here. And he happened to run into Carla, and they had a wonderful conversation, and she rightly said, well, Clarence, you're too big for politics and prose. But this was, I'm happy you're here. And we're big enough for you, and you're big enough for us, and it's just absolutely wonderful. You know, in the world of journalism, I like journalists, especially when they're thoughtful and they're wry and they're ironic and they're humorous and they have some serious things to say. Clarence Page meets all those criteria. We don't get to read them enough, at least some of us who still use a newspaper, and so there's no obvious Washington outlet, but we get to see you on television, and you're a wonderful contrast to a lot of other people who are on television with your thoughtfulness and your good judgments. This is a wonderful book because it deals with tough subjects, and Clarence knows how to write about tough subjects, whether it's diversity, but it also has humor. It's full of alliterations. It just proves that you don't have to be Agnew to use alliterations. gaffes, gaps, gotchas. That's a wonderful chapter here. And I'm glad you weren't so shy as you didn't write about your Pulitzer Prize columns that helped do that, because that's one of the wonderful ways of closing. And for me, who earned my learning about advocacy and politics and the civil rights movement, what you wrote about Thurgood Marshall is very moving. So let's welcome Clarence Page to Politics and Prose.
Thank you so much. I can't tell you, I am thrilled to be here, and I'm nervous to be here. Well, she's saying something, and I tell you, for me, because I told my wife this earlier, and she said, it's because these are people you know? I say, yeah, that's right. That's right, you know. I just came back in from a whirlwind tour of a bunch of spots between here and Philadelphia and Chicago. And there are some places where you get nervous because these are folks you know. You know, it's like and I do feel like right here at Politics and Prose, I'm coming home in so many ways. And it's one thing to write a column that is primarily aimed at other markets around the country, and then to come back home to the folks you live with every day. You see what the difference is. I used to be a local columnist back in Chicago in my first few years, and it's something about writing about folks whose world you're going to go back home to after you leave at the end of the day. And here in Washington, the whole world is our world, isn't it? I mean, it's really, this is a place where doormen and taxi drivers feel personally responsible for the future of Western civilization. And you got to love it. And this is something that, I decided today I'm going to read a couple of columns for you that don't deal directly with politics, but deal more with the topic that I mentioned in my title. Folks ask me, why did you choose culture worrier as opposed to warrior, but no, worrier with an O? And I will point out a couple things. Number one, I want people to do double takes when they go through the bookshelves. Number two, when I get interviewed, especially live broadcasts, it forces the announcers to say it twice. So the more mentions, the better, right? But furthermore, there's a I went over 30 years of columns. This came about earlier this year when I woke up one day and said, holy cow, I've been doing this for 30 years. And my second thought was, if Charles Krauthammer can do it, so can I. So thus the book. And as I went over 30 years of columns to see if I had learned anything, I was, first of all, I must say, impressed with this bright, young, feisty voice that I saw there on the page, and I wonder whatever happened to that guy. And secondly, I noticed that while I'm primarily a political columnist, I found myself writing more and more about culture, because culture has been one of the real buzzwords of politics over the last few decades. And the big question, does culture change our politics? Do politics change our culture? As an African American of a certain age, now, when I say certain age, I mean I was born colored. And then, right about the time when I was in high school, and I have a couple of college classmates of mine here in the room, so I don't want to say too much about how old we were exactly, but I'd say I was about halfway through high school when we went from colored to Negro, as in three dozen Negroes were arrested registering to vote today. And then, a few years later, so I hit the campus, and we became black. And then I realized, after about 20 years after that, I remember Reverend Jesse Jackson in a news conference said that we ought to call ourselves African American. I said, well, I like that. I mean, I was in Chicago, and I went to the phone, called my parents, and said, oh, Mom, Dad, we've got a hyphen, too. Because in Chicago, your hyphen means everything. You know, from St. Patrick's Day in the spring to Columbus Day in the fall, and with St. Stanislaus Day, Pulaski Day, Puerto Rican Independence, or rather, El Borriqueño Parade Day, Bud Billiken Day in the black community. Everybody gets a hyphen. And we suddenly had one, and I found this to be a very unifying thing, despite all of the commentary that said, he's being divisive, he's fragmenting our society. That's one of the things I'm concerned about, is social fragmentation. And now, in recent years, I learned that we are people of color. So I know I have seen a lot of progress in my life, going from being colored people to people of color. Let's hear it for the of. In any case, funny thing about being a columnist, for those of you who've done this sort of thing, you know that I'm the kind of columnist who follows the headlines. And so, you know, we come right after whatever political, social, economic development happens in the headlines. What can I say about this? And I remember Mike Royko, who's the spiritual mentor of every columnist in Chicago, when asked what he does for a living, said, I explain things. And that's kind of what columnists do. This is why we still have been able to survive this era of the encroachment of the bloggers and the compression of all thoughts into 140 characters, that people still look, with all of the information flow that we have now through so many new media, old media, there is even a greater need than ever as we try to sip from this fire hose of information coming at us, even more need than ever for somebody to offer an opinion that other people can bounce their opinions off of. And my dear colleague Eleanor Clift is here today. I'm just delighted to see her. And I, you know, we are, you know, folks who are part of, I think we're part of the problem, right, Eleanor? I mean, we what my grandma always called the shouting show. There we are. And
we're such a small
That's right. That's right. And I mean, our show is downright elegant and polite compared to those many imitators that have come along after us. But there, I love people who are passionate. That's why we both love Pat Buchanan, don't we? And Pat's a great guy. Just don't talk politics. You'll get along just fine. In any case, I, you know, in looking back over what columns offer something that I think lasts, what thoughts are as relevant today as they were then, I did come across, well, the Thurgood Marshall column was one of them, quite frankly, because it was really a magical moment for me when I came here to Washington right at the time when Marshall was stepping down from the Supreme Court because of ill health, and just a remarkable figure. And, I should read that one. Why not? You talked me into it, twisting my arm like that. My goodness. Without taking too much of your time here today now, this rejuggles things a little bit, but that's okay. I'm going to do the Thurgood Marshall, James Brown, and Mrs. Kendall, my high school journalism teacher. Every time I do one of these programs, I find something different because there's a lot in here. And I wasn't expecting it to be this big, but this has been pruned down. But anyway, each of these means something to me in a different way. And I think they each say something about the times that we are in, as well as what it's like to write under deadline pressure. And I told my wife, who I'm sure will survive me, that my a proper epitaph for me would be nothing concentrates the mind like a firm deadline. And I think it was Oscar Wilde who said, I love deadlines. I love that sound they hear as they whoosh by. For indeed, life is never-ending struggle. But it's really amazing how, you know, once the mind is concentrated, what the observations that you can come up with. And so I mentioned Thurgood Marshall because that was something that happened all of a sudden. And I didn't know in the beginning what I was going to say by the time I got to the end. And the same thing is true when the Godfather of Soul passed on. And same thing when my high school journalism teacher hit her 99th birthday. So I will read in that order. And then throw it open to questions. And if you want to talk politics, great. I live politics. Godfather of Soul and of Our Goal, December 27, 2006. Could James Brown really be gone? Are we sure? After all, no one could stage a false exit better than the Godfather of Soul. You know what I'm talking about. He'd be singing please, please, please down on one knee at the foot of the stage, his face gleaming with sweat, his pompadour gleaming with pomade. After 2 hours of sweet, pulse-pounding soul stirrings, then his dapper assistant would appear and drape a bright satin cape over Brown's shoulders, and soul brother number one would slowly stand up and turn around slowly and step rhythmically off stage as the band and backup singers moaned, please, please, don't go. And the crowd would go wild. And Brown would stop, shake off the cape, which the dapper aide would catch in the nick of time and dance back to center stage for an encore and another and another. It was pure cornball showbiz, but we, the James Brown baby boomers, loved it. Because Brown did it with so much, yes, soul. In fact, he defined soul in the 1960s and forevermore as much as Sam Cooke or Aretha Franklin or Ray Charles or the Supremes or Jackie Wilson or Marvin Gaye or anybody else in the rhythm and blues pantheon. His 1962 Live at the Apollo hit album set the mood for countless blue light parties in our basement, our parents' basements. You know about the blue light parties? Anybody not know? Okay, I see a few hands up there. Yes, indeed. Something about that magic dark room with nothing but a blue light to illuminate the whole thing. Anyway, his eye-defying, quick shuffling, rubber leg dance moves were widely imitated but never quite duplicated. Others like Joe Tex or Jackie Wilson or Al Green might be able to drop the mic, spin around, drop into a split, catch the mic before it hit the stage floor, but never with the same level of style, flair, and all-out screaming passion as Brown. Ever wonder where Reverend Al Sharpton found his erotic air styles? Blame Brother James. J.B. befriended Sharpton, then a prodigious teen preacher and youth leader, who became Brown's road manager in the 1970s. When Sharpton married, show business and civil rights activism, he learned from the master. Ever wonder why Mick Jagger started dancing like a madman on stage? Blame Brother James. As a singer, Jagger was a remarkably calm-looking chap, till the Rolling Stones were booked to follow Brown in the Santa Monica Civic Auditorium in 1965. As the Tammy Show, Teenage Music International video documentary reveals, the hardest working man in show business whipped those California kids into such a frenzy that a nervous young Jagger decided to explode onto the stage with an improvised chicken walk dance that soon became his trademark. Jagger has hardly stopped moving on stage since. After surviving the Motown wave and the British invasion, Brown proceeded not only to, quote, go political, as many performers did in the 1960s, but write the anthem for a new socio-political consciousness. Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud. No one drove the nail into the coffins of colored and Negro as acceptable labels as much as Brown's song did. Yet his music and message, I prefer the lesser-known anthem with a mouthful of a title that says it all. I don't want nobody to give me nothing. Open up the door, I'll get it myself. Musically, the song's compelling beat displays to full effect Brown's distinctive emphasis on, quote, the ones. That's the one and the three instead of the two and the four in his rhythms. Its message offers an important response to the many people who were asking in the midst of urban riots and a rising black power movement in the late 1960s, what do black people want? If Brown's answer is what it sounds like in his songs, quote, we want equal opportunities, not guaranteed results, unquote. It comes no surprise that he endorsed Richard M. Nixon in 1972 for president. After all, it was Nixon, not John F. Kennedy or Lyndon B. Johnson, who actually signed the first affirmative action executive order into law. Looking back, it is easier to appreciate the message Brown was trying to give. Black power rose in 1966 in the wake of a civil rights movement as a slogan in desperate search of a program. Brown, a seventh grade dropout, suddenly became the least academic but most influential voice to give a little intellectual meat to the new movement. As an impressionable student, I was changed forever by Brown's recounting in an interview in the late 1960s about his own struggles against childhood poverty. I used to shine shoes in the front steps of an Augusta, Georgia radio station, he said. Now I own that radio station. So could we all. He was telling our generation, if we took full advantage of the doors that were opening up to us. Unfortunately, Brown took great advantage of those open doors, only to lead a life of maddening swings between wealth and ruin, artistic genius and spouse abuse, amazing fitness and drug abuse. Yet he kept coming back for encores and honors. The curtain has come down on his turbulent life. This time his exit is for real. But we still have his music, his memories, and his messages still taking encores for many years to come. Thank you. That's for Brother James, right, George? George Pelikanos is here in the room, ladies and gentlemen. Do it me the honor, a man who has mixed literature and R&B to full effect. much appreciated. My eyesight is worse than the last time I went on book tour, but that's age for you. Here we go. February 5th, 2012. Time to shatter the black suicide myth. The death of Don Cornelius, creator and host of Soul Train, brought two conflicting memories to mind, the weekly joy of that iconic program as a defining feature of black American pop culture, and the terrible pain inflicted on the surviving family and friends of those who commit suicide. Like countless other boomers, I grew up with Soul Train. Today, the old clips look like an amusing period piece, especially to our kids or grandkids who wonder how any of us could have thought those Saturday Night Fever fashions were cool. But the 1970s and beyond, Soul Train defined cutting-edge cool. It became the longest-running syndicated show of its type on TV, and as Cornelius said every week, the hippest trip in the galaxy. But the hip trip finally came to an end a few years ago on TV, and for Cornelius, amid reports of failing health. Police say he died in his Los Angeles home of a self-inflicted gunshot wound. That tragedy had special meaning in the African-American community, which has long nourished a dangerous myth that black people don't commit suicide. It's a point of mythical ethnic pride that our ancestors found ways to persevere despite centuries of slavery, struggle, and hardship. Black people created the blues, it's often said, because we didn't have psychotherapists. Besides, as an old joke goes, we black folks don't kill ourselves because you can't kill yourself by jumping out of a basement window. We can only wish that were true. Although whites and Native Americans have the highest suicide rates according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the black suicide rate has been high enough in recent years to claim one African American every 4.5 hours. No group is immune. By gender, non-Hispanic whites and Native American men have the highest suicide rates of about 25 lives per 100,000. That's more than 4 times the rate of women in each racial group. It's also more than twice the rate of black and Hispanic men, whose suicide rate is about 11 per 100,000. It's 5 times the rate of black and Hispanic women. Asian American men have a rate of about 9 per 100,000, slightly more than twice the rate of Asian American women. Yet the black suicide myth persists. Quote, as a mental health advocate over the years, I've heard variations of the black people don't commit suicide meme, wrote Basie Ipke of the Black Oriented, Basie Ikpe on the Black Oriented, The Root website after Cornelius' death. Quote, yesterday the chorus was deafening. People went so far as to create elaborate conspiracy theories rather than accept what could be a simple truth that Cornelius had taken his own life, unquote. I share her sense of frustration. I suddenly became an expert because of a personal tragedy, as many Chicagoans know. Back in May 1984, suicide ended the life and career of Lenita McLean, an award-winning Chicago Tribune columnist and ghetto to Gold Coast success story. She was also my former wife. She killed herself with an overdose of prescribed pills 2 years after our divorce. Her upward career trajectory, like our marriage, was stopped only by the furies of her relentless depression. Happiness is a private club that will not let me enter, she wrote in her, quote, generic suicide note. It is not hard, although it is not pain-free either, for me to imagine that Don Cornelius could have written that same message. Suicides inflict a terrible cruelty on the survivors. Everyone asks why, and there are no easy answers. I was surprised by how many of my friends came forth to share stories of their own loved ones who had ended their lives or come close to in their severe depression. I was shocked by how common such illnesses can be, regardless of race or community background. I also learned about guilt. People feel guilty if they failed to get help for their lost loved ones, a counselor told me. And they feel guilty if they did get help and the loved one killed him or herself anyway. It is best to seek help. Whether you believe it or not, you have too much to lose. That was, I had mentioned that one to you beforehand, but I was turning to the Thurgood Marshall essay and I found myself reading that essay instead, which comes right ahead of it. This one is The Legacy of Thurgood Marshall, June 1991. How do you want to be remembered, I asked retiring Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall, calling my question over the heads of reporters at his farewell press conference. Squinting in my direction, the old curmudgeon appeared to be at once amused and irritated as he reflected for a microsecond, then muttered in his gravelly voice that he did what he could with what he had, that he did what he could with what he had. It would make an appropriate epitaph. Whether you loved what he did or hated it, Marshall gave it all he had and dared you to feel neutral about it. Those who argue that Marshall should be replaced by another African American miss the more important point. Justice Marshall's value was not in his color, it was in his conscience. If the web of justice is a great national safety net, Marshall was its last remaining anchor at the end that sympathized most with people too powerless and causes too unpopular for politicians to touch. He embodied what Oliver Wendell Holmes was talking about when he said, the life of the law has not been logic, it has been experience. He understood the hard luck cases because he'd been one of them and often had defended them. Marshall brought to the court his experiences as one who had suffered the indignities of second-class citizenship at a time when his skin color kept him out of most restaurants, hotels, and the Maryland Law School he wanted to attend. He later graduated at the top of his class at Washington's mostly black Howard University. He also had argued more cases before the Supreme Court than his fellow justices had, 32, of which he won 29. He was the only sitting justice to have defended a convict who had been sentenced to death, and he knew the meaning of rough justice, being the only justice to have found as a defense lawyer that one of his clients had been lynched before Marshall's train arrived in the Texas town where the suspect was to be tried. He was accused of liberal activism. If so, he leaves behind a court guilty of conservative activism. Reversing 4 important earlier court decisions the same week Marshall announced his departure, the new court seemed discontent to let a day pass without stripping away another right. This is a court that allows coerced confessions, random, warrantless searches of bus passengers, censorship of adults-only nude dancers, and the admission of victim impact statements to fire up the emotions of juries considering the death penalty. The danger in these decisions is in the line of thinking they represent. Although Ronald Reagan promised to let government off, get government off people's backs, the court he revolutionized is helping state powers expand at the expense of individual rights. A court that takes a cavalier view of the intimidating nature of uniformed police asking to search without a warrant shows precious little appreciation for why we want warrants in the first place. A court that justifies a local ban on nude dancing in an adults-only establishment because of the possibility that it might lead to criminal activity might as well confiscate driver's licenses because they too might lead to criminal activity. A court that allows victim impact statements in their commendable regard for the rights of victims or their survivors who are willing to testify shows a callous disregard for the rights of victims who, for whatever reason, do not testify. And a court that views some coerced confessions as harmless error apparently sees little harm in its encouragement of sloppy police work, like accidentally dropping a suspect down a staircase, for example. Marshall's most powerful parting shot came at the an explosive dissent he lobbed into the court's 6-3 victim impact decision on the day of his retirement announcement. Quote, "Power, not reason, is the new currency of this court's decision-making," Marshall thundered. "Today's decision charts an unmistakable course," he continued. "Cast aside the day are those condemned to face society's ultimate penalty. Tomorrow's victims may be minorities, women, or the indigent. Inevitably, this campaign to resurrect yesterday's spirited dissents will squander the authority and the legitimacy of this court as a protector of the powerless. I dissent," unquote. The ring of Marshall's dissensions shall echo through the halls of justice long after the man has left, a lonely voice that tempered sound legal logic with the warm flesh and blood of human experience. Thank you. That's for Thurgood. Now, very quickly, with your indulgence, you've been so nice here. You just let me abuse you like crazy, but just one more reading here. Getting personal once again. I didn't find my life to be that terribly interesting, but once in a while, things happen that make me write about myself to some degree. This was in September of 2013, and the headline was High School Newspaper Ink Drying Up. I was thumbing through my class of 1965 high school yearbook a few years ago when I was stopped dead cold by an autograph left by one of my teachers. "Dear Clarence, all I ask is that you mention my name when you win your first Pulitzer Prize. Don't forget. Don't forget, Mary Kendall." I was stunned. It was 1989. I had just won a Pulitzer Prize for commentary. While I was getting over the shock, reporters were calling with usual reporter questions. "How'd you get started? Who was your inspiration?" Et cetera, et cetera. I've often said parenthetically that every reporter should go through the experience of being covered. It is indeed... is indeed illuminating and helps one's empathy toward those whom we cover. Anyway, that's why I was thumbing through my yearbook to refresh my memory. It's embarrassing to blow facts, especially when the facts are of your own life. My life in journalism began at my high school student newspaper under Mrs. Kendall's supervision at Middletown High School in Middletown, Ohio, where she also taught a one-credit-hour journalism class. My initial media goals were modest. I didn't have much of a social life. Journalism, a field that compensates articulate nosiness, and noisiness for that matter, was a good way for me to meet people. Mrs. Kendall encouraged me to pursue my media interests and, just as important, help pacify my alarmed parents who wanted me to be a doctor. I put down my yearbook and called Mrs. K. By the way, my parents believed, like Woody Allen's mother, that life begins shortly after you finish medical school. Anyway, I put down my yearbook and called Mrs. K. She didn't sound surprised to hear what she had written. Quote, "I always knew you could do it," she said. I thought she probably issued her challenge to all her young aspiring journalists. I said, maybe, she responded, quote, "but you're the only one who's taken me up on it," unquote. I apologized to Mrs. K. for tooting my own horn with this anecdote. She encouraged modesty and humility in her aspiring journos. Oh, how I have failed. Put the story first, she instructed us, not your egos. But I have a couple of good reasons for this deep dive into my anecdotage. For one, Mrs. Kendall turned 99 recently and deserves this shout-out. Happy birthday, Mrs. K. At an August reception with four birthday cakes in her honor at Middletown's First Presbyterian Church, she told me she feels fine. Her only complaint was a persistent numbness in her hands that makes it hard to type or use the telephone, a poignantly cruel twist in my view for someone who helped to improve my skills on typewriters and telephones. My other justification for these memories is to sound an alarm for the endangered state of high school journalism. Opportunities for today's aspiring or potential high school journalists to receive on-the-job learning like that offered by Mrs. K are slim and getting slimmer. Even in New York, the media capital, only one in eight public schools has a student newspaper. The New York Times reported in May, and many publish only a few times a year. Nationally, about two-thirds of public high schools have newspapers, according to a 2011 study by the Center for Scholastic Journalism at Kent State University. But whether on paper, online, or online, student newspapers tend to be absent from lower-income schools and lower-income students. That's sad because, as Robert Fulghum titled his bestseller, "All I Really Need to Know I Learned in Kindergarten," unquote. I often feel as though I learned all I really needed to know about journalism in high school. Newspapers of all sorts have been battered for decades by television and widespread illiteracy. With the explosion of internet traffic, too few youngsters are learning good news literacy. As Mrs. Kendall taught, you need to be a good reporter before you start giving your opinion. Today's world of blogging and tweeting encourages the opposite. Too bad we don't have more Mrs. Kendalls to go around. Let me say as a postscript, oh, thank you. As a postscript, I'm happy to report in September, Mrs. Kendall turned 100. And I went by the wonderful facility there in Middletown. She's not the oldest person there. One of her girlfriends is 106. So anyhow, I know we should be so lucky right now. But anyway, I said, "Happy birthday, Mrs. Kendall." And she said, "You forgot to say, and many more." That's the spirit. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and I look forward. Thank you. Thank you very much. I look forward to your questions, comments.
We're going to have the question period, and Howard Norman certainly knows the procedure because he's at the microphone.
He's ready.
I've got a long list. I'm only going to ask one.
Everything here is recorded, and today everything is being filmed as well. So that's why we want you to use the microphones. And I know you can be heard without them, but everybody else can hear you with them. And so that's the idea, and we'll begin. Howard?
Clarence, the intimacy of the columns sort of invites a question that might be personal. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering, we talked briefly.
And you know about personal writing.
Yeah, right? I do. Well, indeed. We were talking the other day, and the question I never got to ask you at that house was, whatever your private life and thoughts is, columns are very public by definition, mm-hmm. which means that in an opinionated world, you get a lot of opinions sent to you in response, which means, I don't know if you'd call it an epistolary life, but you have people sending you letters. Has there been any instance in your writing life, your career, in which a letter sent to you began either a discourse with that person that continued or got you to think in a different direction, not in opposition to what you had written, but perhaps in a parallel way? I'm especially interested I can only imagine how many hundreds of letters you've gotten in your life. From
275 per day, the emails there. I've averaged it out.
Emails.
Yeah, but most of those are what we would call junk mail for various candidates, especially now, right?
Because you mentioned typewriters and telephones, so maybe we could go back to when people actually wrote letters.
That too, yeah. I could say a lot about that. I'm reminded of a William F. Buckley collection of emails and correspondence, and the title was "Cancel Your Own Damn Subscription." I love it, you know. You know, that's what a perfect answer, you know. you know, it's funny. I think one of my first lessons as a columnist was that if you write about upsetting stuff, you're going to upset people. And if you issue strong opinions, you're going to get strong opinions back. Some with a varying number of letters and syllables to the words in their vocabulary. But I also found early on that the very next week, if you write something that same person agrees with, you get another email or a letter that says, you know, you're the best thing since sliced bread. Thank God you're there, you know, speaking up, blah, blah, blah. So bottom line is don't take it personally. And that's not easy to do, but because we're all emotional people. We all want to be liked and loved. But at the same time, I'm also always dissatisfied if I don't get a bunch of negative mail for a column. Well, first of all, if I don't get any mail for a column, I'm really upset. if I find the hate mail to be remarkably reassuring that somebody's paying attention, and then you've got the people who are really nice, and let us not play them down, because those people who are really nice take an extra effort, because if you're emotionally wrapped up in something, you're going to write right away. But the nice people, I don't want to take them for granted on one hand. On the other hand, I'm at a loss as to what to say back to them except thank you. I guess it's really, but when I have somebody I disagree with, I got a lot to say to them. But I've also learned the hard way not to get into a back and forth with these folks who just sound quite irrational, because you're not really going to get anywhere. Because a lot of people, I think, read columns for therapy. They're lonely people, and they now have the internet, so they can just spout off to whoever they want to after their own grandchildren have stopped listening to them, and. So on the one hand, I feel like I'm performing a public service as a sounding board here. On the other hand, somebody who would disagree with me but really have something to say, and they've read the column and they're responding to me in a with a rational argument. I love getting in dialogues with folks like that, and I have. They didn't tend to be too rare, unfortunately, but it has worked out to a point where I've even gotten column ideas from that. So I don't want to play that down either. But what can be really hilarious, though, is to get the folks who are well. I will say one of the things about the negative mail is that they're my most loyal readers, which is why, you know, I might make fun of the of their reasons for doing it, but they're my most loyal reader. I got to respect that. You know, when you get somebody who says, there you go again, you liberal pinko, blah, 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 you're saying so-and-so, but back in July 26th of 2011, you said this. Now, they have obviously taken some effort, and I also occupy a place in their memory and their lives, so you've got to appreciate that, too. So yeah, like I say, I could write a lot just about the kind of correspondence that gets kicked up, and especially in this media age where it's so easy. Thank you, Howard. Yes, you've been very patient. Thank you, sir.
You are...
Peter, tell us your name.
Peter Levin.
Okay.
Enjoyed success as a columnist and coming up through the print media, and then participated in the television, which programs which my wife wouldn't even stay in the room for.
And they are kind of testosterone heavy, right, Eleanor?
Yeah, I was sure Eleanor at some point was going to have a stroke on the program. And I have to ask you, especially in the only one of those programs, by the way, that I really would get something out of was Gordon Peterson's show here on Friday nights, which was canceled.
Indeed. Yes, indeed.
And you could even get some good from Krautheimer on that show at certain times.
I mean, sure.
It brought out the best in people.
Absolutely.
The other shows with all of you being people of success in print and all was kind of a perpetual shouting match about things. How do you feel in retrospect about the usefulness of serious journalists participating in that kind of activity?
Yes.
And it's if you say we got paid, that's okay. But then beyond
that's my short answer.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no, fame and fortune are my short answers. Or as the late, great Jack German used to say, it put my daughter through dental school or whatever, or medical school. This is an ongoing question and issue, which we have a lot of fun with this. But I think it's, for one thing, my serious answer, first of all, is I always liked the McLaughlin Group because it had a wider audience than Washington Weekend Review, for example, which is a certainly more dignified show, much more focused on the actual wonky facts and all of the news. But I've penetrated Fraternity House Row, for example, through the McLaughlin Group. Thanks to the McLaughlin Group, I've been lampooned in Mad Magazine, and thus scoring cool points with my son, who was in the fifth grade at the time. And right about that age when a young man is discovering Mad Magazine, or at least I did. This was quite a moment. I remember my late friend Gene Siskel used to say, he felt his life had truly arrived when he and Roger Ebert were lampooned in Mad. You suddenly find yourself kind of stepping out of straight journalism, per se, and into this world of showbiz, where... Neil Postman's wonderful book really goes into this in great depth about how journalism has become kind of an adjunct of the entertainment industry, a lot like professional wrestling and other things. But at the same time, though, we want to broaden our audience. One of the big challenges of media these days is reaching young people. And that was before the internet got really going. And even so, there's this interesting generation gap now in the media, thanks to this new age we're in now to reach younger readers. I've had to learn how to tweet, which for me is a completely unnatural act compress my views into 140 characters. However, I have learned that this is a different culture, and now I got this community. I'd already Facebooked, by the way. I was introduced to all this. Sorry to go on so long, but you invited it. I first discovered Facebook when my son said, "Oh, Dad, nobody uses MySpace anymore," and he was right. And I got onto Facebook and discovered that right about the time when my whole baby boomer generation was getting on Facebook, and we just kind of took it over. People I never thought I'd ever talk to again from basic training and from my scout troop, from high school, etc. We just can't get enough of it now. And the kids have moved on to Twitter, and so I finally got it into to Twitter and found a whole new dialogue. But now I can tweet links to the McLaughlin Group on Twitter, and I can my son now tells me that Instagram is where I ought to be. All right. But I went to Instagram. All I saw were pictures, and I said Instagram is Twitter for illiterates. So that's where I am right now. Stay tuned. We will see. This is the kind of world we're in. The funny thing is, I mean, people used to say, is discourse falling apart because of shouting shows on TV? And I mean, McLaughlin Group started. By the way, McLaughlin Group evolved out of the predecessor to Gordon Peterson's program, which was the old. I'm sorry. Gronsky and Company. Thank you. It can't be a senior moment, John told me this. It was partly inspired by Gronsky and Company, partly inspired by Buckley's firing line, just ratcheted up a few notches. Buckley didn't have to shout; his vocabulary was enough. The much imitated but never quite duplicated McLaughlin Group, I think is. Something that what's remarkable to me is how we develop this relationship with the audience so that we become part of people's lives around the country. They set that time aside to go and commune with us Washington folks. And at the same time, though, I think that the durability of straight journalism, it's like columns versus blogs. There's lots of blogs out there, and that's fine. I blog myself sometimes. But what a journalist really wants, regardless of what they do or write about, is they want audience. and they want people who have less and less time for media each day. You know, say you got 15, 20 minutes on average to devote to all the news on the planet. I, as a content provider, my new title now, right? Yeah. Because that's what we are, journalists, and we're now content providers. You know, I want you to come to my content in that time frame. So there's that new competition. But we've always been competitive. It's just competition has sped up. So I think on the whole, much too late for my short answer. In essence, though, I think we the joy of the founding fathers and what they put into the First Amendment. They were fathers, and thanks to modern DNA, we know they fathered more than we thought they did. But I digress. Anyway, the brilliance of the First Amendment is this marketplace of ideas that is now opened up. So we've always had competition between the media. Now it's just more fierce and more choices to make. But this is where news literacy, like I said, Mrs. Kendall taught us, is important, that people understand how to differentiate between a good news source and an unreliable source. But that hasn't changed. Only the technology has changed. But thank you for your question.
You didn't answer the question.
No, but I got a column idea out of it. The day, I'm going to spend all day running around this. But do you want to restate it very quickly?
Well,
which part I missed?
The question is, and this is all pre-Facebook and all that stuff.
Yeah. What was useful about McLaughlin Group?
Yeah,
for the public. Yeah, well, again, the what's useful about it is that we brought, boy, I'm going to mix metaphors, but we brought eyeballs into the tent. I mean, when I worked for CBS years ago, they used to say, we want to get people into the tent. You know, in other words, reach that audience, lure that audience to the news and the issues. Most people don't have a whole lot of time during the week to pour through the papers every day like I do, go through the web and all. But they've made McLaughlin Group a part of their week. They will set aside that time. And so I think a program, either that program or other programs, that do pull in an audience that doesn't normally follow the news every day, have a special responsibility. And that's the part that I appreciate about it, because we do reach guys in the frat house or other places, people who aren't news junkies like we are. And this happens to me all the time. You know, people stop me in airports, and it's also funny to kind of, sometimes you can look and talk to somebody for 30 seconds and guess whether they are a fan of McLaughlin Group or the PBS NewsHour. And I'll let your imaginations go with that. But I love them all. And they all ask me, number one, what's John McLaughlin really like? No, the first one is, how can you stand all that shouting and blah, blah, blah? Second one, what's John McLaughlin really like? And third, how can Eleanor stand all that stuff, blah, blah, blah? Your fan club is immense, Eleanor, I want to tell you. But thank you for your question there. Yes.
Hi. I want a shout out to Eleanor. I'm a documentary filmmaker, and her son is a very good documentary filmmaker. Oh,
yes.
Glenn Marcus. Two quick questions. Is there a fan under your lectern?
No.
Okay. And
no.
And did you or did you not vote for Barack Obama?
No. Oh.
No, it's too related. No. You're referring to the current imbroglio.
That's funny. You would never guess who I voted for in 2012, so I'm not going to tell you. So they
anyway, two serious, semi-serious related questions. Your Chicago journalism colleague, Lynn Sweet, after Obama was elected, started covering Michelle.
Right.
And she felt that it was something she was qualified to do, and also that it was an opportunity that worked for her, and some people expected her to do that. Did anyone ever expect you to cover Obama in that way, being, you know, from Chicago and more?
Yeah.
Second question is, any comments about the Times versus the Trib or anything in Chicago politics you'd like to tell us?
I can speak for days about that. But, I think that the question about how, you know, what expectations of me as a commentator goes back to that first couple of weeks when I first started doing this, because I found a lot of people want to put you into a box right away. And as our politics have become more polarized, that box gets bigger and the walls get higher and tougher. When I went into a national syndication, a couple of years after I started writing the column, 3 years after, the editor had a meeting between me and the regional sales directors of the syndicate. And the first question they asked was, by the way, Clarence, what are you? Huh? Remember me? My first thought, being from Chicago, my first thought, when somebody says, what are you in Chicago, it means Polish, Irish, Italian, you know? And but no, they wanted no liberal or conservative. And I've been writing a column for 3 years and hadn't even thought about that. You know, am I liberal or conservative? And so I hemmed and hawed, kind of like a Kentucky senatorial candidate who was asked about, did you vote for Obama or not? But I kind of hemmed and hawed. I'm thinking through the whole roster of issues in my personal agenda and couldn't make up my mind. And finally, after about 20 minutes of discussion, they came up with a marketing slogan for me. He's liberal, but he'll surprise you sometimes. And so I've kept that, you know, because, I do surprise people. Sometimes, like, for example, I'm not opposed to school vouchers. I'm in favor of all kinds of choice, any kind of option. Somebody's got a good, as you well know, any kind. I love how I planted this audience, not even knowing. But you remember the documentary I did on school choice. And I've oftentimes written, I love when I get called a flaming liberal and a gutless conservative for the same column, you know, because I want to. That's where I want to be. I want to just be able to care about not what's right or what's left, but what works. And so that's my approach. So I say all that as my long-winded way of saying that there are certain expectations people will have of me, and they'll get very disappointed if I don't fit those expectations. Like if I criticize Obama, like I did last Sunday, my headline was Obama : the thrill is gone, because I was talking about how his approvals are down, not just across the board, but among a lot of his own core supporters have various reasons for disappointment. I'm not just talking about Cornel West, but people who agree with him and wish he'd fight harder and blah blah blah. I mean, there's all kinds of reasons. And so this was a column about, you know, that 6-year slump that 2-term presidents have. But yeah, I got several letters from people calling me a Uncle Tom, tool of the corporate establishment, and you've sold out again, Paige, and blah blah blah. You know, but that's, I don't take it personally. So, because as long as they keep reading. Hope that answers your question. Good. I don't want to take up all afternoon here. You folks are wonderful. But thank you very much.
We're going to let you sign books.
Thank you. I will be here signing books. Thank you. Oh, great.